إِنَّ الَّذِينَ Indeed those people who يَرْمُونَ الْمُحْصَنَاتِ Who falsely accuse chaste women. Those people who accuse al-muhsanat. And remember the word yarmuna? You have done the word earlier as well. And primarily it is used for accusing someone over here of zina. So those who falsely accuse women of zina, but which women? Al-muhsanati al-ghafilati al-mu'minati. Those who are muhsanat. Muhsanat is a plural of muhsana. And muhsana, as you know, is used for a married woman. It's also used for a chaste woman. It's also used for a free woman. Over here, it gives the meaning of chaste woman. Those women who are chaste. Those women who do not do wrong things. Who guard their chastity. Who have haya. And al-ghafilat, plural of ghafila. Who is ghafila? Someone who has ghafla. And what is ghafla? That a person is heedless, that a person is inattentive, that a person does not pay attention to something, that a person is not that smart, he does not use his mind a lot, or that he's not too clever. You understand? This is the meaning of ghafil. And we think that being ghafil is something that is wrong. That is when it is with regards to religion. That a person is not smart when it comes to the deen. He does not pay attention to the deen. He's not that clever when it comes to the deen. And clever and smart with regards to the deen does not mean that a person knows what to do and how to get away from certain things. No. It is that a person pays attention to every aspect. And he gets the maximum out of the different situations. So, ghafilat over here gives a sense of those women who are very naive, very innocent, who are not that street smart, you can say. Very innocent women. So first of all, they're chaste. And secondly, there are very innocent women who never even think of doing anything wrong. Who never even think of doing zina. This thought never even crosses their mind. They're so chaste, they're so innocent, that it can never ever be imagined that this woman would do something like that. Like for example, Aisha radhiyallahu anha. She was a chaste woman. And she was an innocent woman in the sense that it could never be imagined that she would commit zina. Never ever. You see, there are certain people, if you hear that they have done something, you're like, I'm not surprised. If you hear that they have done something wrong, whatever that wrong may be, what do you say? I'm not surprised. But if there are some other people, and you hear that they have done something wrong, you're like, I cannot believe it. I cannot believe it. I cannot accept it. Why? Because they're so innocent. They're so naive. It's not possible they would do something like that. So, al-ghafilat are women who are very innocent, very naive. And thirdly, al-mu'minat, those women who believe in Allah and His Messenger. So those people who accuse such women, muhsanat, ghafilat, mu'minat, those people who accuse them, Allah says, لُعِنُوا فِي الدُّنْيَا وَالْآخِرَةِ They have been cursed in this dunya and also in the akhirah. How? That they are distanced from the mercy of Allah. In this dunya, they will be punished. And what is that punishment? What is that punishment? To falsely accuse someone of zina without producing evidence? That a person is given 80 lashes. And many times it happens that people are successful in accusing innocent, chaste women of committing zina. And what happens? People will come and give false witness against her. It has happened many times, many places in the world, that people will come and give false witness against that woman. Like for example, a woman is raped. And then there come four witnesses standing up against her that she has committed zina. Apparently the man who has done zina with her, he is never held accountable, but she will be held accountable. So, it's possible that the punishment is not inflicted on the accusers in this dunya, but what does Allah say? لُعِنُوا فِي الدُّنْيَا Whether or not the punishment is inflicted on them, such people are cursed in this dunya. They're distanced from the mercy of Allah in this dunya. And not just in this dunya, but also in the akhirah. وَلَهُمْ عَذَابٌ عَظِيمٌ And for them is a great punishment. Why? Because accusing chaste women of zina is of the major sins. Abu Hurairah radhiyallahu anhu, he said that the Prophet ﷺ said, shun the seven destructive sins. Leave the seven destructive sins. And he was asked, what are they, O Messenger of Allah? And he said, associating partners with Allah. Magic. Killing a soul whom Allah has forbidden to be killed. Consuming riba. Consuming the property of orphans. Running away from the battlefield at the time of war. And accusing chaste women who never even think of anything touching their chastity and are good believers. So accusing chaste women who are ghafilat, who never even think of doing anything wrong, this is what? Of 7 destructive sins. It leads a person to la'na fi dunya wal akhirah and also adabun azim in the hereafter. So this is a great warning from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for those people who dare to accuse chaste women. Some have said that this ayah is specifically with regards to the wives of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. However, it's not just about them, but it's about any woman who is chaste, who is innocent, who is a believing woman. If anyone accuses them, then for them is this punishment in the dunya and the akhirah. And also notice over here in this ayah, only women are mentioned. Why? Why are women only mentioned? Because many times women are accused. Many times women are accused. Like if you think about it, in this incident of ifk, who is in the limelight of the two? Aisha radhiyallahu anha. It's always the woman who is blamed. It's always the woman who is punished more. And the man is not held accountable as much. The man is not punished as much. The man is not reprimanded as much. But the woman, she is accused. She can be punished without even being proven guilty. So this is why in particular women are mentioned. However, the same rule also applies to accusing chaste men who are believing men who never even think of doing anything wrong. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, يَوْمَ تَشْهَدُ عَلَيْهِمْ, on the day that it will testify against them. What will testify against them? أَلْسِنَتُهُمْ, their tongues, وَأَيْدِيهِمْ, and their hands, وَأَرْجُلُهُمْ, and their feet. Why? بِمَا كَانُوا يَعْمَلُونَ, because of what they used to do. Al-sina is a plural of lisan, and aidi is a plural of yad, and arjul, rijl. Okay? Rijl is foot. So on the day that their tongues, their hands, and their feet are going to witness against them. How? That they're going to say that, oh Allah, this person said such and such. The tongue is going to say that, oh Allah, this person used me to say such fahisha words, to spread such false rumors. وَأَيْدِي, and their hands with which they did actions, these hands are going to testify against them. And the أَرْجُل, the feet with which they walked, those feet are going to testify against them. Why? Because our bodies, they don't actually belong to us. They're very loyal to Allah. We may not be that loyal to Allah. We may not have haya of Allah, because of which we do many wrong things with all of these parts of body that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given to us. But they actually belong to Allah and they're loyal before Him. This is why. Save yourself from yourself. It's possible you do something today and you think, it's okay, it's just my hands, what's the big deal? But these very hands will speak against us on the Day of Judgment if we have abused them, if we have not used them correctly. Think about it. People, they are so concerned about their hands and their feet. They're so concerned about them. They'll get manicures and pedicures regularly. They'll cream their hands and cream their feet and make sure they're wearing socks and make sure if they're driving and it's extremely hot in the summer, they're wearing gloves so that their hands don't get tanned. People are so careful when they're washing dishes, they'll wear gloves. They'll use such soaps which are very delicate on the skin. Why? Because we're so concerned about the physical appearance of our hands. And we don't think about what actions is it that we are doing with these parts of our bodies. If you think about it, physically these hands will decompose. No matter how much you take care of them, eventually what's going to happen? They're going to end up in the grave and then they're going to be decomposed. But what is going to remain? The actions that you have done with these hands. And on the Day of Judgment, when this body is going to be resurrected, these hands are not going to speak for us if we have abused them. They're going to speak against us. This is why when you look at your hands, when you look at your feet, tell yourself, they don't actually belong to me. They're not going to remain loyal to me. If I'm doing something wrong, like for example, if you're using your hand to beat someone up, spank a child unnecessarily, and more than what is necessary, more than what is needed. Just imagine if a person is using his hands to type something that is wrong, text something that is incorrect, write something that is wrong. With the feet to go somewhere where he should not be going, where she should not be going. And with this tongue, talking about things which a person should not be talking about. The same tongue, the same hands, the same feet are going to speak up against us. بِمَا كَانُوا يَعْمَلُونَ. In Surah Yasin, Ayah 65, we learn, الْيَوْمَ نَخْتِمُ عَلَىٰ أَفْوَاهِهِمْ وَتُكَلِّمُنَا أَيْدِيهِمْ وَتَشْهَدُ أَرْجُلُهُمْ بِمَا كَانُوا يَكْسِبُونَ. That day we will seal over their mouths. Their mouths will be sealed. People will not be able to speak. And their hands will speak to us, and their feet will testify about what they used to earn. يَوْمَ إِذٍ. On that day, يُوَفِّيهِمُ اللَّهُ. Allah will pay them in full. دِينَهُمْ. Their recompense. And how is that recompense going to be given? Al-haq, meaning that which they deserve. Al-haq, the truth, meaning what they deserve. He will give them the exact recompense which they deserve. Not less, not more. وَيَعْلَمُونَ. And then they will know, أَنَّ اللَّهَ, that indeed Allah هُوَ الْحَقُّ الْمُبِينَ. He is the truth. He is the perfect in justice. Al-haq, from the root letters, حَقَّ أَفْقَاف, and حَقْ literally means truth. And al-haq for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, al-haq is one of the names of Allah. What does it mean? That one who is true in his being, one who is true in his uluhiyya, in his rububiyya, and no one shares in these matters with him. So al-haq, first of all, with regards to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, means one who is true in his being, in his existence, in his names and attributes, in his uluhiyya, in his rububiyya. And al-haq with regards to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also means zul-haq. The possessor of haq, meaning the one who judges by haq. The one who makes judgment according to the truth. So, أَنَّ اللَّهَ هُوَ الْحَقِّ, that indeed Allah, He is true. And that He is the just one, the one who makes judgment according to the truth. And al-mubin, most evident, very clearly. He is the one who makes the most just decision. So what do we see in this ayah? That each person will get on the day of judgment what he deserves in full, with nothing at all being reduced from his recompense. Now if you look at it, these ayat being revealed over here, there is severe warning. That many times we talk without thinking. We do things without thinking. We talk about fahisha, we spread rumors, we assume things about other people, we fabricate lies about other people, and we spread them without even thinking about the consequences. This is a very, very scary ayah. That think about it. On the day of judgment, this tongue will speak against you. On the day of judgment, you will get the recompense that you deserve. You will not be able to avoid it. So be careful about what you say. Be careful about what you do. Be careful about where you go. In Surah An-Najm, ayah 41, we learn, ثُمَّ يُجْزَاهُ الْجَزَاءَ الْأَوْفَى. Then on the day of judgment, he will be recompensed for it with the fullest recompense. Who? Each person. He will be given the fullest recompense. Nothing less, nothing more. Exactly what he deserves. In Surah Ali Imran, Ayah 161, we learn, ثُمَّ تُوَفَّى كُلُّ نَفْسٍ مَّا كَسَبَتْ وَهُمْ لَا يُظْلَمُونَ. Each person will be recompensed for what it has earned, and they will not be wronged. And we have learned earlier that the deeds of each person will be weighed. And the scales, the mawazin, what are they? They are of truth. They are not faulty. And if there is misqala dharra, if there is something that is equivalent to the weight of an atom, even that will be recompensed for. So be very careful about the assumptions that we make about other people. About the things that we say about other people. Because they can lead to very severe consequences in the hereafter. It's so easy sometimes to just pass on the information that you have heard, to say something very easily out of your mouth, but the consequences are so heavy. This is why وَالَّذِينَ هُمْ عَنِ اللَّغْوِ مُعْرِضُونَ. They have no interest in love. They turn away from it completely. Then finally, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, الْخَبِيثَاتُ لِلْخَبِيثِينَ. The evil ones are for who? Evil ones. Al-Khabisat is feminine, and Khabiseen is masculine. And Khabisat, Khabiseen, has been understood in various ways. First of all, it has been said that Al-Khabisat, meaning evil words, like for example, talking about scandals, talking about fahisha, taking interest in indecent conversations. Who do they suit? Lil khabiseen. They suit khabiseen people, the impure people. Because your speech, your conversation, what does that reflect? Your personality, your interests, who you are. Whatever you talk about, that reflects who you actually are. So bad conversations, khabees kalimat, khabees words, they suit who? Khabees people. And you, O people, are who? Alladhina amanu. If you are believers, then talking about scandals does not suit you. Talking about indecent things does not suit you. Who does it suit? Khabiseen. Secondly, it has been said that al-khabisat again refers to khabis statements, khabis kalimat, and it refers to the accusation of zina. The accusation of zina, that someone has committed adultery. This suits who? Who can be accused of having committed adultery? Someone who is chaste? Someone who is tayyib? No. These accusations, they suit who? Lil khabiseen, the khabis people, not the pure people. And this is a very, very important rule. That when you hear that somebody righteous, someone chaste, has been accused of something that is wrong, you cannot accept it. Like for example, over here in this incident, what happened? People had accused Aisha radhiyallahu anha. Who was she? A pure person. They had accused Safwan radhiyallahu anhu. Who was he? A chaste person, a believing man, a companion of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. They were not of khabees people. Therefore, such accusations, such statements cannot be said about them. Slanders, accusations, they can only be said about who? Khabiseen, not tayyibin. Thirdly, al-khabisat has also been understood as evil women. Meaning women whose interest is zina, women whose interest is, you know, men. So, such women, who do they suit? Lil-khabiseen, impure men. This is just as we read earlier, al-zani la yankihu illa zaniyatan aw mushrika. That a zani person will only be interested in a zaniya woman, and a zaniya woman will only be interested in a zani man. So similarly, al-khabisatu lil-khabiseen. And Aisha radhiyallahu anha, who is she? Who is she? She is of the tayyibat. And she is the wife of who? The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So how would it be that Allah would give to His Prophet a woman who is unchaste? A woman who is khabisa? Not possible. Because al-khabisat are for who? Al-khabiseen. The impure women, they suit who? Impure men. Allah would never choose for His Prophet a woman who is impure. Wal-khabisuna. And the impure men are for who? Lil-khabisat, for the impure women. Again, this will be understood as that al-khabisun, meaning evil men, evil people, they are the ones for whom are lil-khabisat. They are the ones who deserve khabisat, evil words. Wal-tayyibatu. And on the other hand, the pure women, or the pure words, the pure kalimat, good remarks, positive remarks, therefore who? Lil-tayyibin, for the pure men. So Aisha radhiyallahu anha, who was she? She was a tayyiba woman. This is why she was married to who? The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, who was definitely tayyib. So wat-tayyibatu lil-tayyibin, wat-tayyibuna lil-tayyibat. And the pure men are also for who? For the pure women. So primarily what is being said? That what suits something evil is what? Evil. What is like it. And what suits something good is what? Good. What is like it. You get what you deserve. So if there is a person who is righteous, he will only say good things about them. And good things can only be said about who? A righteous person. It goes both ways. If there is a person who is righteous, you will only say good things about them. And good things can only be said about who? A righteous person, a good person. And on the other hand, if there is someone who is bad, then his reputation will make you say bad things about them. And bad things can only be said about who? Bad people. وَالطَّيِّبُونَ لِلطَّيِّبَاتِ Allah says, أُولَٰئِكَ those. Who does أُولَٰئِكَ refer to? The طَيِّبُون and the طَيِّبَات. The pure men and the pure women. Allah says they are مُبَرَّؤُونَ. They are ones who are absolved of responsibility, meaning they are innocent. مِمَّا يَقُولُونَ from what they say. Those people who are pure, who are clean, who are innocent, who are chaste, who are righteous, they have nothing to do with what the corrupt men and women say about them. So for example, about Aisha radiallahu anha, about Safwan, evil things were said. What does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala say? They are مُبَرَّؤُونَ مِمَّا يَقُولُونَ لَهُمْ مَغْفِرَةٌ وَرِزْقٌ كَرِيمٌ And for them is forgiveness and also a noble reward. So in this ayah, the companions of the Prophet ﷺ have been honored. The wives of the Prophet ﷺ have been honored. The Prophet ﷺ himself, he has been honored. Because when a person is righteous, then he deserves a righteous spouse. When a person is righteous, then he deserves a righteous reputation. Then people can only say good things about them. And this teaches us a very, very important lesson. That if you hear something evil being said about a righteous person, never accept it. Never accept it. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says over here, Al-Khabisat lil-Khabisin. Evil words can only be said about who? Evil people. They're the ones who deserve them, not righteous people. It's not the other way around. We listen to the recitation and then we'll continue. Pure men are for pure women. Pure women are for who? Pure men. And evil men are for evil women, and evil women are for evil men. They're the ones who deserve one another. And the Sahaba of the Prophet ﷺ, the Sahabiyya, they're not impure. They're not evil. Therefore, nothing evil can be said about them. And also, it includes evil words. If you think about it, what is included in evil words? Because what is being said over here is that evil words can only be said by who? Evil people. Because good people, they talk good. And evil people, they talk evil. So what is included in evil words? Gossip. What else? Backbiting. What else? Swear words. Foul language. What else? Mocking at other people. Very true. So, who can say such word? Someone who is bad. Someone who is bad in his nature. Someone who is bad in his iman. Someone who is khabith from inside. It's not possible that someone who has iman in his heart is a tayyib person. He would say foul words. He would like to backbite. He would like to listen to gossip. It's not possible. This recently somebody was telling me about this person who attended this seminar, which was organized by this Christian organization for their missionaries and people who run different things such as churches, etc. And this was a Muslim person who went to attend to see how is it that these people work. And the organizers of that seminar, the man who has a particular business, he says that one of his rules is that anyone who is caught gossiping is going to be fired. Anyone who is caught gossiping is going to be fired. He is not allowed to work in that place anymore. Because the work that is being done is a work of God. And God is your boss. And everything that we have to do has to be according to what God likes. So if you do anything that goes against the teachings of God, you're not allowed to come here. So just imagine, if somebody is caught gossiping, he's fired. And literally, many people have been fired because of that. Similarly, there was a person who was in a very high position. He was caught cheating on his wife. He was fired. He was fired. Why? Because this work is supposed to be good work. And only good people can do this kind of work. And people who indulge in evil, people who indulge in khabith actions, they don't deserve to do such type of work. And over here, the same thing is being said, that al-khabithatu lil-khabithin. Evil words can only be said by khabith people. And al-khabithun, the evil people, they are the ones who are subjected to khabithat. They are subjected to say khabith words. Because your reputation precedes you, and your tongue speaks your heart. Those who are evil will talk evil, and those who are good, they will speak good. And khabithat does not just include words and women and people, but it also includes a'mal, evil actions. Evil actions such as zina, they can only be done by who? People who are evil. And righteous people, they will only do that which is approved. So this ayah is very, very important. And it's a very big test for all of us, that all of us need to analyze ourselves. That if my conversation, if my speech includes indecent words, it includes gossiping, it includes backbiting, then am I in the category of khabithun? Am I in the category of khabithat? Or am I in the category of tayyibat? Because this is a very, very important test. And it's a very serious one. Each person can analyze himself over here. If I take interest in evil things, if I take interest in evil words, in fahisha, then this is where I stand in the sight of Allah. So each person should be very, very careful. Unfortunately, many people don't consider such words and actions to be khabith. They think that, you know, there's only certain things that you have to do in religion. Other than that, you know, do whatever you want, say whatever you want, go wherever you want, it doesn't make a difference. Whereas we see that it makes a huge difference. This shows the status of a person in the sight of Allah. That we see in the ayah that وَلْيَعْفُوا وَلْيَصْفَحُوا أَلَا تُحِبُّونَ أَنْ يَغْفِرَ اللَّهُ لَكُمْ وَاللَّهُ غَفُورُ الرَّحِيمُ. That when a person, he is looking at his own actions, his own sins, then it will be easy for him to forgive other people's mistakes. Because if we cover other people's mistakes, how? By forgiving them. Then inshallah, Allah will also cover our mistakes, how? By forgiving us. Because part of covering the mistake of the other is forgiving him. Because what does maghfira mean? Satru dhamb. To cover the sin, to not talk about it. But generally, what is our reaction? If somebody has said something bad to us, we go and publicize it. You know, she said this to me. Can you imagine? She did this to me. This is not maghfira. This is not forgiving. This is not covering. If you don't cover the sin of the other, then Allah will also not cover yours. You see, throughout these ayat, women are being defended. Women are being protected. Constantly, yarmoon al-muhsanat, those people who accuse chaste women, they're being mentioned. And women are being mentioned exclusively. Why? Because women are generally attacked. So look at how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protects women. Look at how He defends them. He secures them. And if you notice the names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that are mentioned over here, or His favors, that it's out of His fadl, it's out of His rahmah. Wallahu ra'ufun. He is very compassionate. So it's out of His mercy and affection and great favor that He is giving these rights, and He is protecting the women from those people who can harm them. And you will learn in the following ayat as well, that all the commands that are given, even they are for the purpose of the protection of women. And you will notice that. That how the women are being given their rights, and the society is being taught certain rules that you have to observe them, so that the woman can be safe, she can be secure, she can be free in her house, and she is given her privacy. So the etiquette is being taught to the entire society, so that the woman is safe. She is protected. And it's out of the favor of Allah, out of His great mercy. A very good observation, that الطيبات للطيبين والطيبون للطيبات. Many times it happens that if a person, he comes closer to the religion, he becomes more practicing, he becomes more careful about the religion, people make him worried and concerned, or her, that how will you get married? Who will you get married to? But what do we see? That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, والطيبات للطيبين and والطيبون للطيبات. There is someone who is pure, who is good, who is also in the deen, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has reserved for them. So don't be hasty. Don't be impatient and think you have to leave the religion or you have to become, you know, less serious about the religion so that you can get married to someone. If you remain tayyibah, then you will get someone who is tayyib, provided that you are patient, inshallah. That in this ayah also, الطيبات للطيبين الخبيثات للخبيثين, what does it show? That your partner, they show your status. They show who you are. Your friends, they show who you are. Especially the spouse. That if you are a particular way, your spouse will also be a particular way. If you are a particular way, then your friend will also be a particular way. So generally, a person is known by who? By his partner. Now there are many situations where one is very much in deen and the other is not at all in deen. It's completely different. There are certain situations where this happens. However, generally, a person will only get along with someone who is like them. Isn't it so? They will only get along with someone who is like them. الطيبات للطيبين. And it's possible that they're not exactly the way you are, but they may have a lot of good qualities in them. That perhaps they don't do many wrong things that other people do. They have some very good morals and ethics, which they very religiously follow, and they believe that that is necessary for them in order to remain as an obedient servant of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So it's not necessary that if someone is very knowledgeable, then their spouse has to be extremely knowledgeable as well. If somebody is very pious, then their spouse is also of the same level. Now don't think that, you know, my spouse is not like that, then maybe I'm not supposed to be of the tayyibat. No, it's possible that you have one quality and your spouse has another quality. Okay. سبحانك اللهم وبحمدك نشهد أن لا إله إلا أنت نستغفرك ونتوب إليك السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته